Keep us, Lord, you remember all you've been so good to us. We praise your name. We lift up your holy and righteous name. And now, Lord, as we come to this peculiar and but precious moment of the proclamation of your word, you know the condition and the circumstances and desires of each and every person gathered here. Lord, bring us together. Although we have a diversity of needs, we're united in that we all need you. So, Lord, give us what we stand in need of. But most of all, look upon my weakness, weariness, and look upon my shortcomings, Lord, and remove them and allow me to be able to stand in your presence with a clean heart. And, Lord, take my nothingness and make something out of it and make my words your words. And allow your words to fall on receptive hearts and receptive ears and be used for your purpose. These blessings we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. This morning we conclude our series on the necessities of the Christian life, inspired by the 17th chapter of the Gospel of Luke. And this morning we're going to conclude, or based on that text, preparation, a necessity for Christian living. Preparation, a necessity for Christian living. The text that was read by Minister Nelson reminds me of a childhood game that we probably all played, a game called Hide and Go Seek. We called it Hide and Go Seek. Well, we would close our eyes and count. One, two, three. Ready or not, here I come. Somebody played the game. Well, it reminds me of the text. The text reminds me of the game because ready or not, Jesus is coming back. Jesus is coming back to gather his church and to judge the living and the dead. So the question is, are you ready for Jesus to come back? Donaldson Chapel, are you ready for Jesus to come back? Yes, Jesus is coming back. So the issue is we must get ready for Jesus' return. Thus, preparation is a what? A necessity for Christian living. And with that in mind, if you would briefly turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 52. Kind of go a little further ahead in the New Testament and look at something and just break it down and make it clear so we're all on the same page about how the Apostle Paul struggled with the issue when he was dealing with new believers in the city of Corinth. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 52, because our text, we're in the gospel with Jesus on his way to Jerusalem prior to his death, resurrection, and ascension. But 30 or 40 years later, the Apostle Paul, dealing with this issue about preparing and getting ready and when the Lord will return, wrote these words, and repeat them after me. In a flash, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet, for the trumpet will sound, the dead will be raised imperishable, and we will be changed. Amen, amen, amen. So just kind of bring it home to make this a point that Christ's return will be sudden and unexpected. Christ's return will be sudden and unexpected. So, brothers and sisters, we must be ready. We must get ready. We must be prepared. And that's what we must do. I'm here to tell you, many years ago, when we moved from Easy Town and moved down on Oldham Highway, it was the country back then. But nothing happening out there back then. We used to sit down in the front yard and count cars. And sit out there all day, you might count about 10. At that time, when my mother started working, she'd come home by 5. So that means the house was supposed to be clean by 5. But most of the time, if anybody would come that way, I'd get me a ride back to Easytown. And see, down in Easytown, on the other end of the street, my aunt worked, and she got off in the evening. And Paula, Godfrey, and Larissa was supposed to have the house clean. Now, that's on both ends, Old Hammond in there. And I tell you, if you didn't have that house clean by the time they got home, it was hell to pay. But my thing was, when I got old and I would hitch that ride, that means I wasn't there to clean up. And my sisters would get mad. And then I would go down the street and bother Paula, Larissa, and Godfrey until it was time for their mama to come home. And I'd leave them. And so I didn't have to do any work. Because I was more interested in hooking up with some of my, hooking up with Hal, and we were going to either do something we wasn't supposed to do, at least talk about doing something we wasn't supposed to do. But, I never did get the hell pain when they got there. But, you know, we won't be able to do that when Jesus returns. We won't be able to hitch a ride, because we don't know when he's coming back. And we knew what time the Brown House and Gotchall was going to let them go. We knew what time they were, but we don't know when Jesus will come back, because his return will be sudden and unexpected. And the best thing we can do is get ready, get prepared, and be ready, because Paul said, in the twinkling of a flash, at the sound of the last trumpet. So we need to get ready. But we need to do proper preparation. We need to do proper preparation for the Lord's return. And proper preparation will teach us that proper preparation is not about fear and speculation, but about faithfulness and service. So where am I getting that? Back to our text. In Luke chapter 17, it said Jesus is on his way to Jerusalem, and he's teaching the disciples, and a disciple is a learner, not to be what? Like the Pharisees. And the Pharisees ask a question there in verse in the early part of that pericope in verse 20 and 21. They ask Jesus about the kingdom of God. And this is not what you need to know about the kingdom of God. To know more about the kingdom of God, you need to be in Bible study, Sunday school. But to make a long story short, the kingdom of God is where God controls. The control of God. And depending on what translation you have, he said, because the kingdom of God is within you, in the NIV, and in something like the NRSV and other translations, it says the kingdom of God is in your midst. So it's two things. One is where God controls, and God, you cannot be part of the kingdom until you submit and give God control of your heart, your very inner being. But the other thing Jesus was telling them that was God, when you interpret the Greek, is that, he's talking to them. I'm right here among your midst right now. The kingdom of God is here right now, because I'm standing in front of you. You've watched me heal the sick. You've watched by the powerful and profound teachings. I've fed the hungry. You can see the Spirit of God is moving right here and right now. So the kingdom is here. And what I'm here to tell you, that you're sitting here with a beautiful congregation, that the king, have you given God the control of your life? Because the Spirit is moving, his presence is moving in here, and are you part of the kingdom? Because what? The Lord is here moving in the midst. But most of all, he's here through his Spirit, but he's coming back. He's coming back. And we need proper preparation. So Jesus began to teach them after, teach the disciples. You will notice in verse 22, then he said to his disciples, in verse 22, then he said to his disciples, because it was important for Jesus to teach them, the disciples, because they would be the church and his representation here on the earth like us. And he taught them, and brothers and sisters, there can be very little preaching if there's not any teaching. There's not any teaching. Teaching is very, very important. So Jesus, then he said to his disciples, he told them he had to go away, but then when we get down to our text in verse 26, that's where he's making the point about proper preparation. We don't know the time. We don't know when the Lord returns, but he is coming back. Turn to your neighbor and say, he's coming back. Turn to your neighbor and say, are you ready?
Are you ready?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, we're looking good, but are we ready for the Lord's return? Let me say, proper preparation is not about fear and speculation, but about faithfulness and service. So when you look in that verse, when you look at verse 20, 26 through 27, you will see that he was talking about in the days of Noah, in the days of Noah, and in the days of Noah, you can see that they were eating and drinking, and everybody was doing the thing, but what? The Lord found what? Favor, what? With Noah. That in the midst of whatever going on, the Lord would what? Find favor on what? God's people. Those who were doing what the Lord told them to do. But what? We know the story. What? The Lord destroyed the living creatures through what? Through what? The flood. But there was what? Noah and his son, right? And their wives. So there was eight who were delivered by God. And they were delivered because of what? They did what the Lord told them to do. So proper preparation is not about fear, speculation, but about faithfulness and service. We can speculate. We can calculate. And you can probably go to some stores and turn on your television. Somebody can tell you they don't think when they gonna know when the Lord returns. How they gonna know when the Lord returns when the Lord said nobody knows. Nobody knows. Nobody knows. So people use fear and speculation to manipulate other folk's lives. It usually costs you about $19.99 or $15-$20. To find out when the Lord don't return, when they gonna tell you the Lord don't return, you cost you a little something. So, but it's not. It's about what? It's about faithfulness. Noah was faithful, but it's about service. It's about getting ready for the Lord's return. We often like quoting that passage of scripture in the New Testament that says, "If you don't work, you don't eat." About the love of money. And you know what was going on there? People would sit down and wouldn't go to work, say they were waiting on the Lord's return. That's what would happen. They would sit down and eat out of your refrigerator, ride around your gas money. But they were waiting on the Lord's return. Serving the Lord will pay off after a while, but the Lord expects you what? To serve what? Until the return. So proper preparation is not about fear, speculation, but about faithfulness and service. But you know, and there's another passage of scripture there that Jesus used as an illustration. It was talking about Lot. Because what? Lot was the nephew of Abraham, who was faithful. But he was faithful. But Lot got himself in a jam, and he was living what? In Sodom, an off-the-chain city. Anything would go in Sodom. And it was despicable. The epitome of sexual immorality, paganism, no belief in God. And brothers and sisters, when we go out into a world where all sorts of stuff is going on. But what? The Lord delivered what? Delivered what? Lot from what? Solomon. What? He sent an angel what? In their midst. And how many of you are probably working around in a mess that you're in some throwed off situations? You're in jobs with no future. You're in what they used to call at a popular time toxic relationships. Addictions and afflictions, but somewhere in the midst of your circumstances, the Lord is moving, and the Lord has sent ambassadors and angels and moving in your situation. That's what God did, and told Lot and his wife and his kids what to flee. And God delivered. God delivered. If God just stepped in and delivered. But you know something happened in that. Well, who remembers what happened in that story of Lot in Genesis when they fled Solomon? Mrs. Lot did what? She looked back, right? What happened to her? Turned to a poor son. And what I'm here to say, my brothers and sisters, in the preparation time, in the in-between time, God has delivered us. And we are here, right now, knowing that God has been good to us. God has delivered us. But some folks cannot experience the goodness and blessings of the deliverance because, well, they're looking back. They're looking back. They're looking back. God has delivered you, brother, but you're looking back to that bad relationship. God has delivered you, but you're looking back to that pink slip. God has delivered you, but you're looking back to this and that circumstance. Well, I'm here to tell you that looking back is what? Not proper, what? Preparation. And to reach the goal, I'd like to share with you something that General Colin Powell said. He said, there are no secrets to success. It is a result of preparation, hard work, and learning from failure. There is no what? Secret to what? Success. It is the result of what? Preparation. Hard work and learning from failure. Brothers and sisters, we talked about preparation, but it takes hard work. It takes what? A work ethic. It takes a work ethic. I was talking to Sister Mallory, the director. She said she just returned with Edric this morning at 3 o'clock on their concert tour. They made it in from Monroe, and then she's teaching at Kenilworth, and she has an activity there at 1. But she is here and giving her all that. It takes hard work. It takes hard work. You know, and that's one thing that we're going to get to a certain point. We must remember that. It takes hard work. And then General Powell said, and learning from failures. Once you learn from something, you move forward. You don't keep looking back. When you learn, move forward. You move forward. And that's what many times we cannot what? Get ready for what the Lord. We keep looking back. We cannot get ready for what? The Lord's coming back. If you keep looking back, you can't get ready for what's coming in front of you. So brothers and sisters, looking back is not the proper preparation, but Christ's return will be sudden and unexpected. But I want to tell you that proper preparation requires primary dependence on God. You must depend on God. And it's a spiritual preparation. It's a holistic preparation. And what I'm here to tell you that we have been created in such a way that we have been created for the long haul. God has given us everything what to be prepared. Paul said in a twinkling of an eye, Jesus said, you don't know when or where, but the kingdom of God is just not coming. The kingdom of God is here, and the Lord who created you has given you all that you need to be able to prepare and make it from the inside out. If you want to prepare for the Lord's coming, you got to prepare from the inside out, because what's on the inside will help it prevent you and keep you on the outside, whatever you are going through. Because God has manufactured us, created us with a brain to be able to discern, with a body that can do all, can do so many things, but with a spirit that can encounter Him and experience Him in a unique way. See, when you're getting ready for God, it's a faith dependency. It's a trust dependency. When you know that God is coming back, but the Lord has given you all that you need now. And what you must do is put God first. If you're going to depend on God, you must put God first. You cannot put God on a back burner. You cannot put the Lord on a back burner. We're sitting here and we are affirming and confirming our heritage on this morning. But I'm here to tell you, we stand as the fruit and the legacy of those who put God first. When our sainted ancestors were being shipped and sailed and forced like sardines in a can and through the middle passage, they had to put God first. And as we have come to this point in the here and now, and reclaiming what God has done for us, we got to put God first. I mentioned earlier about Reverend Wright. Now, he's a controversial figure, but I'm here to tell you, I don't personally know Jeremiah Wright, but I've been in his presence numerous times. He wouldn't know my name, but he would know my face. And I'm here to tell you that what you see on the television is not the same quiet man that you see in person. He is a godly man, but he said something in the newspaper. He said something in the newspaper that we should remember, is that black folks, we shouldn't put the government first. We should put God first, because it was the God, the Lord, who brought us a mighty long way. It was God who brought us, and it's God who is bringing us. And as we go, and as we have been reaffirming and confirming our heritage, we have gone to the media in the last couple of years, all of the movies and the television series about our heritage. We must remember to put what? To put God first. You remember it was 12 years a slave, about incidents that occurred right here at Central Louisiana, but I'm here to tell you that only by the grace of God was Solomon Northup able to leave that plantation and head back home, because what somebody they put God first. Just the other last week, I saw a series, didn't see it all, but it was entitled The Book of Negroes, about blacks who left during the Revolutionary War. They went to Canada, they had a hard time in Canada, then they went to England, and slavery ended in England before it ended here, but somebody had to put God first. There's another movie on about a young mulatto woman named Belle. She was half and half, but she put God first and helped end the slavery. We watched the movie Butler about a man born in segregation. treated wrong, but he moved up and found dignity in working in the White House by putting God first. But you don't have to go there. You are here because somebody told you to put God first. Somebody told you, put your hand in the Lord's hand. Put your hand in the Lord's hand. And the Lord will make a way somehow. Somebody told you to trust in the Lord with all thy heart. Lean not to thine own understanding, but in all your ways acknowledge the Lord, and the Lord will direct your path. Young child that I read about the Birmingham, our kids went to see the woman who was in the church at the time of the bombing. Our youth last summer traveled to Memphis to the Civil Rights Museum and saw the history of the trouble. But yes, we had to ask citizens, but they kept their eye on the prize. What you got to do, maybe you might have to sit in, maybe you might, your character might be lynched, but you got to keep your eye on the prize. The Lord is coming back, but you got to keep your eye on the prize. Remember that serving the Lord pays off. After a while, you may get tired of singing, but you got to keep your eye on the prize. You may get weary of praying, but you got to keep your eye on the prize. You may get tired of this, you may get tired of that, but keep your eye on the prize. I don't know about you, but I came to Jesus just as I was. I was weary, I was worn, and I was sad. But in Jesus, I found a resting place, and the Lord has made me glad. Has anybody here, you had to hold on, but you keep your eyes on the prize, because one day the trumpet will sound. One day it'll be the last call. One day it'll be all over. But you got to hear and now keep your eye on the prize. I'm here to tell you, proper preparation requires patience. Proper preparation requires patience, and God has given you all that you need to hold on and hold on, because our God is in control. Does anybody here know that God is in control? Grandma and Grandma found out that Jericho was not in control. Slave master, not in control. False man, not in control. People, not in control. Our God holds the whole world in his hands. I'm so glad that the Lord is in control. I can hold on. I can hold on. God's unchanging hand, because the government doesn't hold. The doctor doesn't hold my hand. The lawyer doesn't hold my hand. Trevor doesn't hold my hand. The Lord holds my hand. He walks with me. He talks with me. He holds my hand. I'm here to tell you, you can be prepared. And here's why you can have the patience. My wife's an educator. And what I learned about being about educators, you know, when they get up, they have numerous classes to teach the next day. Not just one or two, but they may have 5, 6, 7 classes, different students in each one. And what I learned, what they call that when they go home at night, they say they got to do preps. They show up for prep. They got to get prepped for the mom tomorrow. So what I'm telling you here is that whatever you are going through, whatever you're going through in preparation to get it ready for Jesus coming to come back, well, I want to tell you, be prepared for the Lord to prepare you. Oh, you need to get that. Turn to your neighbor and say, be prepared for the Lord to prepare you. And the Lord is coming back, but God is going to prepare you to be ready for what He is coming back. And so I call it God's pre-prep plan. See, the Lord has a pre-prep plan. Whatever you are going through, the Lord is getting you ready for something better. It's a pre-prep plan. I'm here to tell you, when Moses was out in the water, when Moses was running and hiding, God was just his pre-prep plan for him to get ready to part the waters. When God has a plan, God never will give you a plan without preparing you for the plan. God will never give you a vision without preparing you for the position. So what you got to do is hold on in God's prepaid plan, because there's power in anticipated blessings. There's power in anticipated blessings. You don't have it yet, but you know it's coming. That's what Jesus is talking about. The kingdom of God is here. The kingdom of God is near. And the kingdom of God is coming. What you got to do is anticipate your blessings. You know how it is when the good is broke, but you're almost there to that payday time. But you know, if you just hold on a little while longer, they're going to deposit something in your account. If you hold on just a little while longer, there's going to be a credit to your debit card. If you hold on just a little while longer, there's going to be a check in the mail. There's power in knowing that your blessing is on the way. There's power in knowing that Jesus is here. There's power in knowing that Jesus is on the way. I wouldn't have a religion. I could feel sometimes. The love of God in you. Preparation. Preparation is not about speculation and calculation about how many words you know and you can predict when the Lord is going to say. Nobody knows. Nobody knows. But the Father. But the Father. But you know, when you prepare, when you kind of prepare, you know, you got four keys. You look it back. You look it back at stuff that God has already fixed for you. Yeah, God has already fixed it. When you look it back, you mad about this and that and the other. Look it back. You grieving about this and that and the other. Look it back. You angry about this, that, and the other. Look it back. You having your private pity parties about this, that, and the other. Looking back, God has delivered you. Move forward. Actually, learn the chase. You move forward. Can't keep looking back. Move forward. Move forward. Jesus is coming back. We don't like talking about that. Are you ready? Are you ready? Now it's a chapel. Are you ready? Are you ready? And you need to get ready. And it comes come down to spiritual preparation. Are you going to depend on God? You can't depend on the preacher. You can't depend on the church. You can't depend on the doctor. You can't depend on politics. You can't depend on... But if you depend on God, God is in control.
God is in control. God is in control. And when God is, whatever you're going through, is a prep. It's preparing you and building you and making you ready or helping you to get ready. But if you keep serving the Lord with prayer after a while, after a while. So if you're here within the sound of my voice, if you're here and you're living in this city and you are half-stepping and getting ready, we come from a great legacy. Grandma, mama, daddy, Sunday school teacher, they told you about Jesus. And as a child, you put your hand in Jesus' hand. You started doing what you wanted to do. Getting your agenda in your way. But my brothers and sisters, what you need to do at this time, you need to put your hand in the Lord's hand. The Bible says, God so loved the world, he gave his son. If you believe, by grace, your faith, your repentance, you will have the life that only God can give. But if you're listening and you step away from the church, we ask everyone to stand. We ask you to stand in the overflow in the balcony. We ask that you stand. Somebody in here and you're outside the atmosphere. Preparation is not easy.
Still in hope that lies within.
There's power in your anticipated blessing, and that's hope. But you got to get ready from the inside out. Keep your eyes on the prize. Won't you come? Won't you come?
The storm, it all seems. And if the wind keeps on blowing, I'm so
My soul.
Sometimes in life, we're gonna be
tough. Won't you come?